next speaker is Katerina Barone-Adesi, and did I pronounce that well? Is that okay? Okay, more or less. And Andy Wingo, both from Igalia, presenting Snabb Switch, which is a high-performance switch. They'll tell you all about it. Andy presented PF Lua last year. It's an awesome technology project, and they're awesome. So I'm really looking forward to this one. We'll give you a minute to get wired up and stuff, if you want. In the meantime, I guess we're coming up on lunchtime, but the fire announcements, keep off the stairs. I don't think it's going to be a problem for this presentation. Take it away.
So in this talk, we are going to present a few different things. What Snabb Switch is, it's somewhat like DPDK. What we built on top of it, which is an IPv6 transition mechanism, specifically part of lightweight forward 6 model, lightweight after, and some things that we've done to optimize that. It's user space networking in a high-level language, and we're getting near line speed on 2 10-gigabit mix with 1 core. So first, Andy is going to introduce Snabb Switch.
Great. Thanks, Kat. I'm Andy. Thanks for coming with you and Brave. I'll give a little bit of an intro first about Snabb Switch. Snabb is a toolkit for building network functions, routers, packet processors of all kinds. It's for high performance data planes, but in a really flexible, hackable, like very, very fun, it's nice to hack on Snabb, I tell you. So, I tell you, with Snabb we build data planes, but how is it different from other things? Well, this is the DAO of Snabb, right? Simple is better than complex, small is better than large, and commodity is better than proprietary. I'll go through these things as some examples. So for example, how do we actually build like a network function, be it kind of lightweight after which we've built, or a carrier grade NAT, or a simpler NAT, or LTTPD3, or you know, any of these things, right? Well, the Snabb answer to this is it's similar to how we build, you know, pipes and Unix, or how we build our networks by cabling together boxes with specific functions. We develop apps which do specific tasks, and we link them together at runtime into flexible graphs. So for example, in our lightweight after, there's an app which interfaces with the NIC, there's an app which does IPv4 reassembly, there's an app that actually does the lightweight after functionality, and an app that fragments again if we need to on the other side, and back to the NIC again. So composing systems out of simple parts. Another example of like, what does it mean for simple to be better than complex? Well, hands up if you've ever seen the SK buff packet definition of the kernel. Well, that's not this, right? This is what a packet is in Snabb Switch. It is literally, you know, just an array of bytes and a length. And I don't know if any of y'all have had to deal with like kernel network programming, but like, this is much nicer. So, small is better than large. Well, that means like, in the early days of Snabb, there was actually a code budget. Right? An attempt to impose a constraint to force us to be more creative and solve the problem space in different ways. Of 10,000 lines that it had to build in a minute and be less than a megabyte or something like that. As we're growing a bit more horizontally, but the core is still much smaller than the site. So these constraints are allowing us to build small things, but they're very functional. And one of the means that we're able to do this is by using LuaJIT as a language in which we implement everything. In fact, we started with a bit more C, which we accessed from LuaJIT, but as time goes on, we're removing all of the C, all of it, right? We're using system call libraries to do raw system calls. We use a dynamic assembler library to emit raw AVX2 or AVX512 when that comes, assembly as we need to. It's really fun. And also, like, small means we don't pull in a large set of dependencies. Although it runs on Linux, and we're embracing, you know, that target, We don't really depend on the kernel for very much other than, you know, just running our program and pinning it to a core and giving us some huge pages. And we include like the dependency, or the LuaJIT dependency is part of our source tree as well. So you literally just type make in Snabb and you have all these applications bundled in and you can deliver the whole thing as a single binding. And oddly, the network drivers actually fit into small. We don't use DPDK. right? Because the data plane is our domain. We need to find a way to deal with the data plane in Snap. So we have drivers for all the network cards we support, which is obviously not a huge set of cards because we have to implement them all, but all in Lua, right? And it fits in this budget. So the next bit would be commodities rather than proprietary. Well, obviously, the very base level of this these days is to use a free software open source license. And everything we do in Snab is licensed under the Apache 2.0 license. But also, it means that for the network devices we work with, while it's possible to develop the drivers under NDA or whatever, and sometimes we have to do that, we always insist that those drivers have open data sheets. And so the Intel A2599 drivers have been like a staple for what we work with. But recently, we've got an agreement with Mellanox to release their data sheets as open data sheets now because of this work, because we demanded on it, and because we insisted, like, we're not going to make drivers for you, if you don't publish data sheets properly. And we initially have interfaces for Linux Tap, just for running under the kernel if you need to. And also the Vert.io host and guest side. The guest side is relatively new, and I'll talk about that a bit later. Another way in which we double down on, on commodity over proprietary is we don't want to rely on proprietary hardware functionality. We want to rely on Xeon servers, right? Because those, like that is the definition of commodity computing. We're going to prefer to do things on the CPU over doing things on the NIC all the time, right? And that means embracing the architecture of a modern Xeon system. And for that, all my talks recently have had like a section which is like story time. Like story time. Andy tells the story. So where have you heard this story before? Like, who tells this story? We just need to do so much work on data, but there's so much data and it's so far away. It's like, who is having this problem? Like, you can maybe think of people who are having this problem, but like, oh, I skipped an answer. Sorry. In the middle, it's like modern x86 is solving problems, but it's not solving problems for everybody. Right, because the clock speed is the same on our cores. We're getting more cores, but same clock speed or even lower, right? And even the cache can like even decrease in some systems. And main memory is just as far away. Like, it's been 70 nanoseconds, 80 nanoseconds away for years. Like, this hasn't improved at all. But somehow, some people are managing to win. And high performance computing is one of the class of users which manages to win with modern commodity x86 Xeon development. And this happens in three ways, right? One is that the CPU can do more work on more data per cycle once it's actually in the registers, which is hard. You have to get it in memory. Two, the CPU can load more data per cycle once it's in cache, including L3, the last level of cache on these Xeon servers. And three, the CPU can make more requests in parallel to RAM at once. So in the time of one cache miss, you could actually get more than one cache line into your CPU. And that's what we end up doing. We can win too. We don't have to avoid zero, we don't have to like struggle for zero copy. We can embrace the copy. We can make sure that we get our packets into L3 in that packet data structure, which I showed you before, which is literally just an array of bytes. And then we can work on it using our software techniques, because we're programmers. Like, well, I don't know. Some of us come from more, one side or the other, but my side is certainly like, I want to program software, And so once it's in L3, which comes for free with modern NICs, you just DDIO it in, and then you can copy it if you need to, So by embracing simplicity and embracing commodities, like we can actually manage to do more things with software. Yeah. So software is going to eat the world, and this is one of the ways it's going to do it. Because once we're in L3, obviously we can work on assembly, we can get good instruction level parallelism, we can get quite good throughput. And we can do it all in software. We never have to rely on firmware. We never have to say, vendor, please implement this thing for me. Hate that, right? We can invent ourselves. So that's what that's about.
So what about the lightweight after?
Yes.
Yes.
I have to alt tab. Ta-da.
Okay. So on top of
the
I've been building an IPv6 transition mechanism called lightweight after. And obviously, IPv6 transitioning is becoming more and more important at this point because the IPv4 address space is essentially exhausted. And if you're running an ISP, your users will want everything to continue working. They might not have hardware that can support IPv6. They might have old computers or phones that are compatible with it. And there are several different options for IPv6 transition, including NAT64, NVS Lite, and so forth. The one that we've been working on implementing is one called Lightweight 4/6. It's conceptually very similar to DS Lite, but the major difference is that you have less centralized state in it. The basic idea is that you share an IPv4 address between multiple users. Each user gets a port range rather than a whole IP. And the advantage for this for an ISP is that their internal network can be pure IPv6 rather than dual stacked. Lightweight 4/6 has been formalized in an RFC, 7596, late last year. There are two major parts to Lightweight 4/6, which are called befores and afters. They both encapsulate and decapsulate IPv4 and IPv6. And the difference is that the B4s are on the customer's premises, so each customer has one B4, while a network provider has one big after, or a few big afters that are serving everyone. Unlike in DS Lite, the after does not have to maintain personal information about every connection. It just needs to know essentially three pieces of information about every subscriber: the IPv6 address of their B4, the IPv4 address of their B4, and the port range for that IPv4 address, IPv4. And here's a graphical representation of the architecture. You can see that there are customer sites which have a bunch of IPv4 machines. Here it's drawn as one, that connect to a B4. There's the ISP's network, which is pure IPv6, not dual stacked, and you encapsulate IPv4 packets to go across that. And you have the IPv4 internet, which obviously you make an IPv4 connection to. B4 stands for basic bridging broadband element, and after stands for address family translation router.
It's a terrible pun, though, isn't it? Like before and after.
It is, yes.
It took me like weeks before I realized it. I was like, you people are disgusting.
Yeah. So with the address sharing, the idea is that you have a certain fixed range of ports. You specify this with PSIDs, so you can have different sizes of port ranges for different IPv4 addresses. But for any given IPv4 address, everyone has the same number of ports. And so if you have a packet coming in from the internet to customer 1 or customer 2's IP address, you look at the destination port on that to know which one to send it to. And similarly, if you have an outgoing packet, you know which one it's come from and which one to send replies to. The after doesn't have to care about state here, it just needs to know the IPv4 address and the port range so that it can do those lookups. And here's a graphical representation of how the IPv6 tunneling works. You literally stick an IPv6 header around the IPv4 packet. The lightweight after that we've implemented started in July 2015, and we did an alpha release in October. It's already usable in FAST, and it's under an open source license and available on GitHub. When we did the alpha release, we did some benchmarking, and on a pretty standard 2.4 gigahertz Xeon processor with 210 gigabit NICs and 550 byte packets, we were processing over 4 million packets a second, which means over 17 gigabits a second. We were doing all of this on one core. And you might be thinking, okay, what's interesting about software that has one table and sticks IPv6 headers on packets and takes it back off? Turns out that there are a lot of very details from correctly network in the IPv6 tunnel. Something fails and it's going to send an IPv6 message going, oh, that failed. It's not like you can just forward ICMPv6 to an IPv4 host to do anything reasonable with it, so you have to translate that. There's making it fast. Like Andy was saying earlier, if you have to get RAM, it's expensive. If you have, say, a million subscribers, your binding table is going to be big enough that you will be having to get RAM for it, even if your packets are in L3. And there's correctness, because there really are a lot of details. And there's something called haircutting. Essentially, if you have two different customers that want to talk to each other, then you have to send the packet to the lightweight after, and then the lightweight after needs to go and say, wait, this is going to another customer, not the IPv4 internet. We have to re-encapsulate it and send it back out the interface instead of out the IPv4 one. Conceptually, it's simple. In practice, it adds a fair bit of complexity. And now I'm going to go back to Andy, who will talk about how we made the binding table fast when you have a lot of subscribers, and about how he made the haircutting checks faster as well.
Thanks, Kat. Thanks. All right. And we're back. Okay. So, Kat did most of the work on this. I just had a couple small parts. But I've gotten familiar with the implementation a little bit. There are some things that are hard about this, right? The binding table management lookup is kind of hard. And how do you map an incoming packet to the way to partition the ports? I'll bring that a little bit. When do you hairpin? Virtualization is a little bit hard. We want to target, our original target was on working on raw interfaces, but now we're working on VirtIO interfaces as well. There are some policy questions. Everybody wants to have filters on ingress and egress on all these ports. What do we do? And then how do we configure this thing, especially with millions of entries? So, to give you a scope of the problem, like let's say you're an ISP and you want to deploy an IPv6 only interface network, and then you want to deploy IPv4 as a layer on top of this using lightweight 4/6 architecture. So you have millions of softwires or tunnels or whatever the IETF wants to call them this month. And so for each tunnel, you have the IPv4 information, you have the IPv6 information of the 4, and you have some way to partition the ports. So it's at least 22 bytes of entry. If you pack them all together in a table, that's 44 megabytes, so probably you're missing cache all the time. You can't fit it in L3 on those normal servers unless you pay a lot of money. So our deal is we always budget for a miss. Like, we always budget for going out to RAM on a packet, but only one, right? You have time for one round trip, but you can fit in a number of like round trips in that round trip. You can fit in a number of fetches in that one round trip. So let's say if we're dealing with 4 million packets a second for average 500, 550 byte packets managing two interfaces, that's line rate. We have about 250 nanoseconds per packet. Well, one cache miss, okay, it's about 80 nanoseconds or so. I can fetch a number of things there. And our first try of this was an open address Robinhood hash table. We'll write this up soon. This is a longer topic. But the end result is you have your incoming IPv4 address and your port set ID, and your result is probably right where you look for it in the table. If it's not, it's in one of the few words that's right before. So it's pretty good as far as cache locality goes. But it might have to access multiple cache lines, and you don't want to have to make two cache misses for a packet. So then our next thing was we dynamically generate an AVX2 assembly code so that, first of all, you measure on your hash table what is the maximum distance from the initial probe position that your entry might be. And for a table of 2 million entries, it's going to be about 8, right? Something around that. So why not like fetch in all 8 or 9 of those values at once, stream them in to L3, and then, or L2, or whatever it happens to be, and then do a branchless binary search over those. And we use dynamic assembler as well to use a branchless binary search using CMOS, again, specialized to the particular maximum displacement of the table. And then we can actually do this for multiple packets at one time, right? So we're getting in like a bunch of packets in each little cycle of our ACK network. So why not like process 32 packets at a time? And I'm currently measuring amortized 50 nanosecond per packet lookups overhead for the binding table, which is pretty good. And that is quite nice. And that's a worst case problem. Like, that's not, like, you won't get any worse than that, which is a great great thing to say to your customer. Oh, it's going to be 59 seconds, of course. Okay. Also, like, how do we know, like, what is the ports that identify the particular range of ports that you're dealing with for an incoming packet? You need a function which maps your incoming IPv4 and the port to the parameters for that particular IPv4 address. Again, we use an optimized branchless binary search over a partition of the section of IPv4 table that we manage. It's pretty sweet. We need to play with lots of fun Pyler stuff here. This needs to be documented in much more detail in one of these annoying blog posts I write sometimes. So hairpinning is also a problem. We can use the same check for mapping an incoming packet to port set identifiers. We just do a lookup in the same table to see, like, oh, is that part of, is it part of our table? And if so, we might have to actually take the other cache hit to see, okay, the incoming packet on the hairpin match, but maybe the outgoing to get that information, we might have to cache hit there too. But software, we get to use all kinds of, you know, nice software techniques, and we don't have to think on the ASIC level. Time's running pretty short. I'm just gonna zip through here. It used to be that in Snabb, there was only host support, like vhost user support. So Snabb NFV can host DPDK, for example, using virtio.net on the DPDK guest side. Well, now Snabb can also use virtio.net on the guest side, and it's great. You know, we can get, you know, line rate traffic, no problem. We added this in eventually, and combined with work from virtual open systems, thank you very much. And we get the same performance. We didn't have any overhead going from native to virtualized. And we, for policy, like ingress and egress filtering, well, PFLua, it's the compiler from the pflang pcap filter language to Lua, which we implemented last year. And we just popped that in as an app in the network if the user wants some filtering. So it worked really well. That was literally like 2 hours of work. And then to configure it is a problem, right? You have millions of entries, you want to maybe updating entries at runtime. Currently we have a phase that compiles this binary table to an nmap file that's just mapped in. So starting is pretty fast, but actual runtime updates is a to-be-determined story. So in the to-be-determined side, we're going to probably adopt Yang as our central data model for how we configure Snabb and try to push netconf stuff out to some exterior daemon, but, you know, incorporate Yang in our core. We're going to do some more work on getting better throughput for smaller and smaller packets. We currently don't do the fetching multiple packets at fetching binding table entries for multiple packets at a time, because right now we're getting 70 nanoseconds, and to drop it down to 50, we'd have to rewrite some parts of the app, so that's what we'll be doing soon. And we got all kinds of great, you know, 40 gig, 100 gig adapters coming out, so we have to figure out how are we going to do this? How are we going to provide all the internets? So that's about it. Any final words, Kat? Oh, yes, we have, ta-da, we're hiring. Come work with me and Kat, really nice folks. So talk to us later. There's that. And check out from the GitHub. We have our stuff in Igalia. We're still upstreaming it in Snabb. And any questions are welcome, like, what's it like to build stuff with Snabb? Because we didn't know a year ago, and now we know. So it's fresh knowledge. Ask away. Thank you.
I don't understand.
like you said, the people at Virtual Open Systems realize the virtual kernel nets are a driver for us as well. But the kernel has nothing to do with any of this.
Just to be clear, you're doing your own kernel bypasses and not TPDK or old data planes.